So let's open in prayer, first of all, and let's get our focus on to the Lord this morning. So Lord God, we thank you for your blessings to us yesterday and for what you want to do for us today too. We praise you and we bless you, God. We thank you that every day you are with us, part of all that we are doing. We praise you for that. Lord, we just want to ask you now that you would just wash off us all of the stuff of the world that hasn't got anything to do with you, Lord, this morning. You just wash it off us, we pray. We thank you for the joy of family and friends and other things. But Lord, we really want to put our thoughts onto you this morning. Because Lord, we know that you came as our amazing Saviour and Lord. And we want to be grateful and praising you this morning for that. And bless you this morning. So Lord, we ask you to shake it off us, Lord, everything that's not of you. And Lord, we welcome your Holy Spirit here in this place as well, too. That your Holy Spirit might come and bring your presence in our midst this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, you said that where two or three are gathered, there you are in the midst of them. And we just claim your word and your promise this morning. Thank you, Lord. It's so good to read the story again, isn't it? And Luke, I think, describes it really good. It was a huge time, so in chapter 2, verse 1, in those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. And this was the first resurrection when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town, and Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea. And I think that journey was probably, could be 70, 80 miles, I think I read somewhere. It was a really long, long journey. And they went to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. Because he was of the house of the lineage of David, and to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not. But behold, I bring you good news of a great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. When they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. It's interesting, you know, that the shepherds, I just heard the other day, those shepherds weren't just any old shepherds or what you would think, rural people. The shepherds were actually, they believe, the ones who looked after the lambs and raised the lambs for the temple sacrifice. And these lambs had to be perfect. And these shepherds were specially selected and placed there to do that very job. And once a year, the high priest would come down himself to those shepherds and pick out the most perfect lamb. And he would wrap that lamb up in swaddling cloths. And he would take that lamb back to the temple. They wouldn't put it in a cage or in a cart or, you know, along the road. It had to be kept absolutely perfect for the Passover sacrifice. I thought, when I heard that, I thought, wow, isn't that amazing how God connected? Mm-hmm. I've always wondered in my mind, why those shepherds, or what was it about the shepherds? But when you know the tradition of that story and who they were, it really makes you understand, doesn't it? They were the ones looked after the lamb, the sacrificial lamb. I thought, how interesting is that? Really, really good. Yeah, so God had every little detail, as he always does, of course, had every little detail worked out. Bless God. It's good to read it and to just ponder again the wonderment of all that was happening there. And especially, as we said a couple of weeks ago, after hundreds of years of having no real word from God, to now suddenly the Saviour was born. Amazing. So we're going to sing some carols now. Well, let's continue worshiping God, and Lois is going to come up and read us some scripture and lead us in communion. Thanks, Lois.
1 John 5:6-7, which is... Jesus Christ is the one who came with the water of his baptism and the blood of his death. He came not only with the water, but with both the water and the blood. And the Spirit himself testifies that this is true, because the Spirit is truth. These are the three witnesses, which were the Holy Spirit. These are... the next verse anyway. I can't find it, it's disappeared. But anyway, that's... That's a good verse, I think, that's those three. Whoever has the Son has life, and that's... Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. That's not a really Christmassy one. I was tossing up between that and the Christmas one, but they say, do this the truth one in the Alcoholics Anonymous and some of the other groups, that they stop blaming everybody else but themselves. So when you hit the claw, then you'll decide to turn around and acknowledge Jesus. Yeah, but I think it's a very good... Yeah, it cuts through a lot of fear and lies, I suppose. There's a lot of people that lie. A lot of media is very biased towards whatever they choose to be. But so if you'd want to come up and take a... the wine and the elements.
You know what's coming up though? The new year. It's dawn prayer, sunrise prayer. For all you early birds who can get up and come and pray. So it's going to be a great time together as God's church to pray for the year coming ahead. So it'll be great.
Good morning, everyone. Hello. Whatever. So it's lovely to see you today. Thank God that I can be here with you. Just wanted to ask you if there are any highlights of this year for us as a church that you would like to share. You've got to shout it out in a big voice. So I'm asking you to think back on 2021. Most people, when you say 2021, they think, ooh. So let's just change that around and say, what were the good things for us as a church for 2021? So just jump in there. Carol, you look like you're ready.
I just had a bit of a really sense there was a much closer bond between us all.
That's lovely, isn't it? So a closer bond, I'm going to say it so people watching at home can see. A closer bond between us all, isn't that sweet?
Yeah.
What else?
No, I had the same idea, different words, just the unity.
Yeah. Cool, keep going.
I think Rafa, did we join this year? Was it this year where we had special
that was this year?
I think it was last year. But Rafa had a seminar here on, you know, surviving and healing from abuse.
Yeah, that's right.
And that was a real highlight for me for this year. That was wonderful. Partnership, you know. And that enormous Rafa thing with on Zoom with 50 people or more.
Yeah.
The unity, just the love that we're, you know, experiencing for one another is a preparation for what God's wanting to do. Yes. Is it He's wanting to bring the outsiders in and the saved, and they don't want to come in and we're all at each other's throats, you know. They're not going to survive, they'll run. Mm.
That's really what, good.
Yeah.
Wow.
Suppose the church is still open. Church is still open.
Is that a backhanded highlight? Come on. We didn't die.
The welcome. I love the welcome when you come.
Okay. For me, I'm going to jump in with the Praying the Scriptures Day. Do you remember that, Lois? Staff can lead us in praying the Scriptures. That was great having you teaching and a really practical hands-on way of praying for people using the Bible. That was a bit of a highlight. Any more things you can think of? Steve, have you got one?
No.
It's a top answer.
No, that people talk to each other and have you here as well. I mean, that's faster.
That's beautiful. Well, on that note, this book here, which Robin recommended to us, talks about this sort of stuff, about the quality of our relationships. And we did study this a bit, didn't we? We printed out some pages. And we had a brainstorm on how can we do it. And the first suggestion from the brainstorm was prayer buddies. And we implemented that once a month, having a prayer buddy. And that was a ripper practice, I think. I thought that was really powerful. It's lovely to have that sense of responsibility for somebody in the spiritual realm and to sort of pray over them like you might pray over your kids. That was a good one. Yeah, keep going. Highlights of 2021 for us as a church. Paul, have you got one? Highlight for us as a church for 2021? Everyone's talked about the quality of the relationships, Paul, and the beauty of that and the welcome. I'll quickly remind you of, because I've got something on my little printout, I think. What have I got? Look at that. Remember we did this? We had the spiritual authority thing. And it came with a bit of a prayer, which I'll remind you of, because it's actually a statement to the spiritual realm that's really powerful. It's like the spiritual realm is almost like a dog. If you don't train it, it'll get you. So we're going to take authority over the satanic realm and say, if you want to touch my family or my church or my wife or husband or kids, you got to go through me first. And I say no. Yeah, that's a real thing. It works. And so that was a bit of a highlight for the year, I think. And then it led to the total woman thing about from Jean, who sat up here with me and taught about God's miracle in marriage relationships, where a woman can build up her man by letting him be have the authority, and that's a process. It's a miraculous process that happens to some couples, but it's such a sweet advertisement of Jesus' love and God's power when you see that working. It's a type of authority and submission and stuff, which is quite incredible to see.
Well, can I just say, both of those teachings that you took us through were quite impactful.
Yeah.
And
thanks.
Especially on the day that you did the one about the women. I think that was
confronting for a lot of us.
Yeah.
Something we need to hear.
Trying to use the software. Yeah, okay, well, there's a bit of a highlight for the year. Any more highlights you can think of 2021? For me, obviously, a big one was the prayer times up at Mundana Heights. Mm-hmm. I think we maxed it out. We had 30 people or more in the pouring rain. Like, that's a sign of revival when you can't keep the intercessors down. They're just blowing the place up in prayer or whatever. Praise God, the power of God is going to come with all these intercessors just from every nook and cranny out of their burrows.
The Christmas gathering was pretty amazing, hearing people's testimonies.
Yeah, well, that's the next thing, the carols at Labo, you mean? Yeah, we had a carol, we had some great evangelism stuff, didn't we? We had, I'll talk about that in a sec, I think. One of the other things you can think of highlights for the year.
I think a big one for me was the fact that church kept going, you know, Paul kept coming, and we just needed that. You know, we've probably forgotten a bit. I know I was caught up in fear on and off throughout the year. It was a hard year. But how the Lord just drew us back to faith in Him. You know, we don't have to succumb to the fear. He's, you know, perfect love casts out all fear. And I think the fact that the church were with each other, loving one another, encouraging one another, building one another up. We came here, we heard the word, we got it on Zoom, and it just strengthened our faith and our relationship with God, didn't it?
We were one of the few churches that kept going, actually.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely, and that's just amazing. I'm just so grateful that we could come here and meet.
Did
others
too?
A
couple
of churches
closing.
Oh, they did.
Yeah, and I think it was, as you say, enriches your faith because it makes you strip back some of the other things in your life and some of the worldly things and realise the goal that our faith is and the goal it is to be together. Mm-hmm. That sense of family and sense of holding one another up and providing the just presence where we can. Custodians of the presence of God together. We've got to teach on that somehow. The presence of God when we gather is just so beautiful. I've got on my list playgroup. We had a bit of a playgroup all year, which was quite beautiful. We had our relationship with CVAT, who the guys who owned this building was just sort of deepened to know them a bit more, which is important because they're, you know, it's a good place to be, this building. I just wanted to share on evangelism. Harvest Team is a thing we started in January this year, going out once every 2 weeks with a backup prayer team and going out and doing evangelism, trying to meet people and pray for them and say, hey, do you know Jesus? And we use this format and saying, Jesus at the door. And the thing was that morphed is probably the wrong word. We grew and we learned and we reflected and the Lord led us to do like concerts. So I just wanted to quickly show you. Did you see the video of the concert? You went, Jill, didn't you? The carols at Labo. Did you see the video? Anyone? Carol, you went? I'll just show you a minute or two because it's a real triumph. Okay. That's probably enough of that. So praise God that we've been able to do some really good outreach stuff in our local area, and so we had a tree planting one the week before, and that was again bringing like the church out into the street and into their context so people can access some real spiritual food right then and there in the marketplace, and I just praise God for that because it's a good method. You know, it seems to work really well. There are people who want to do that, are Christians who want to get out there and do it, and there's a real need and respect with the non-Christians for this, which blows my mind to see that we've stumbled across a pattern that's quite powerful. So it just comes to mind too that there are people in our midst who are evangelizing. And if you are sharing the gospel in your sort of daily life with people who don't know God, maybe you could put up your hand and we'll just pray for you today. If you're not just family, obviously often that first thought goes to family who don't know God, but if you've bumped into people, if you're making a point of sort of asking to pray for people who don't know God, can you put up your hand, Jill? Anyone else? I know there's some people who aren't here. Carol? What I wanted to do now is just to pray for those people in a little group. So I reckon, Steve, if you turn around, you've got a group of five there. So if you could just think of people who don't know God, and you can just pray now, just for 5 or so minutes. We can make a little group here, Nigel and Lois and Janet. It's a natural thing. Just pray for, we can pray here, of people who don't know God in our circle, that we can, that the Lord's brought to us. I'll just give you an example. I was in the park, just watering the trees, and a kid comes up to me and goes, "Can I help?" And I thought, people never offer help. This is from the Lord. And it ends up that he has these questions. He said, "Well, if God's real, then we're all cousins because of Adam and Eve. What's that all about?" Yeah. So I explained to him about how the Bible, it teaches the who and the why much more than the what. God made the earth for glory and for relationship. That's what's important. The how and the what doesn't matter nearly as much. It does to us because we're from the flesh, but from the God's perspective. And then he said to me, "Oh, but if God's real, how come my grandfather's died of cancer? Why doesn't God make a cure of cancer?" I said to him, "Mate, God works through people. That's the way he set it all up. So the people are trying as hard as they can to fix it." And, you know, I had to explain the fall, and it was a God appointment. So sometimes the Lord brings people to. So is that okay if we just reach out now in prayer for a couple of people who don't know the Lord? And Julie, you need to share some of the people if you've been bumping into. And Carol, if you've been bumping into people, just to share. So we'll just spend a few minutes focusing on that, and then we'll do something else. Is that going to be okay? Give it a try. Yeah? Would you love us? You know, swizzle around a little bit?
Yeah. Well, it's
interesting. So, a funny thing happened to me. I was sitting behind the sound desk, and I believe the Lord wanted me to talk about this. Luke 7:36 to 48. And I know why, but it was a completely different take on what I was about to do. So I'm just going to read it because it's one of the most compelling things. So it goes like this. One of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him, and he went to the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner, when she learned that he was reclining at table at the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment. And standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, for she's a sinner." And Jesus, answering, said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." Imagine Jesus turns to you and says that, "I've got something to say to you." What do you feel, Steve? You're a little bit shaking your shoes, don't you? You think, here it comes, this is going to be good. And he answered, saying, "Say it, teacher." "A certain moneylender," says Jesus, "had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other only 50. When they could not pay, he cancelled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "The one, I suppose, for whom he cancelled the larger debt." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then, turning towards the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she's not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little, loves little." So it's just interesting that as we minister in Cario, the Lord will bring us people who will both be forgiven a lot and therefore love a lot. And I certainly feel that way myself, that I've been forgiven a lot, and the consequence is I love a lot. And so as we think about, you know, we've got to finish in a couple of minutes and we've got 2022 breathing down our neck, it's a good time to reevaluate and to think of the future. And as we think about loving a lot, I've got a really simple, just how do we love better in 2022? How do we love our people in our 3214 postcode and those God's given to us, whether it's family or extended family or neighbours or community? How do we love them better? Just quickly go to our verse for the year, because if you remember, we had this verse from John 15. You did not choose me, but I chose you. Isn't that lovely to know that God chose you? He said, yeah. And you know that deep inside, you know, I belong here. Like Georgia, the girl who came today, she knows that she belongs at Jesus' feet. That you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. So the funny thing about this verse I wanted to focus on is the last part. Whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. It's an audacious thing to say, isn't it? You just want to curl up and, how do you deal with that? So it's got sort of three parts, I think. You've got that part, whatever you ask. You've got the in my name, and you've got the Father will give you. In the message, it's a little bit different. You didn't choose me, remember? I chose you and put you in the world to bear fruit, fruit that won't spoil. As fruit bearers, ask. So whatever you ask the Father in relation to me, he gives you. So I just want to say how exciting this is to see that the power of God is there when we step into that awkward loving others zone, when we take the risk of trying to raise up others and empower others. The power of God comes in. It's the love is like the key. When you're loving and you put the key in, the power of God will come and do whatever we ask. And this is a massive mystery that I think is a thing of discipleship, the long road of discipleship. As we follow God on the long road, the power of God comes in greater measure as we grow in our faith and step out in obedience year after year. The power of God comes. That's terribly exciting to see God working in power. I wanted to finish with this little exercise. It is a daunting thing. I haven't done a particularly good job of unpacking it, but we don't have a lot of time. So let's have a think about this. If God will give us anything in relation to bearing fruit, what will we ask for? To bear more fruit next year, what can we ask God to remove or to grow and provide?
Remove all fear, and less about me, more about somebody that doesn't know Jesus. Because because if we're thinking about us in our fear, it's not going to do.
Yeah, cool. So if you didn't hear that, remove fear, which and make it provide, help me to be more focused on reaching out to others and loving others, yeah, being less worried about myself. Yeah, anything you'd like to shout out to either side, to the God to remove?
Judgment, I think judgment's a big one.
Can you explain what you mean?
Seeing, like, you judge people for the things that might annoy you.
So that's beautiful, isn't it? It's such a common thing for all of us to see people with worldly eyes and to sort of judge them because they've got scars or tattoos or teeth knocked out or etc. or a fancy car or like a fancy handbag or a little poodle or something. And God sees the heart though, and that's where we need to learn to meet them there. That's what you're saying, type of thing, that learning to love her and see her inner life and sort of relate to her God story is so you've got to remove what judgment you called it. Yeah, worldly judgment. It's pretty hard to do, isn't it? It's pretty hard to, but yeah, it's a great one, Jill. Thanks. $10 for Jill. And also, Jill, I'd throw in there that if you're wanting them to know God, wanting to help them in their God journey, in a way, God will bring people to you when he can trust you, when you're good at it, when you're having a go, and he knows you're going to have a go, then he'll bring those people to you. And you've probably got to let some of the relatives go, you know, let them be who they are, because the number of people that God's actually calling to come now, I don't think it's many. Like, you know, you get the odd person who's like really interested. But that, I mean, for me, this is a massive question. If God's going to do whatever we ask as fruit bearers, then we're going to ask, we've got to start thinking about what to ask. Like, let's not be silly and say, oh, I want $1 billion. I did that in the park with the kids. Who wants to see a miracle? The kid goes, oh, what do you want? I want $1 million. I said, no, we're not praying for that. That's not going to help you. And then he said, I want to lead a good life and stay out of jail. I was like, yeah, that'll do. He was 11. But yeah, so what do we want God to do? If we could ask anything. That's a good way to finish, actually, because Paul's given us the task to think about 2022 and what are some of the focus, what are some of the goals, what's the Holy Spirit kind of calling us to seek for at bearing fruit for 2022. Because we're co-workers. I was looking at some, what do you call it, Bible commentaries this morning, and they just landed with, you know, you've got to be submitted to the will of God. I think it's a far more than that. You've sort of got to seek for the will of God. You've got to hunger for loving the people. You've got to be hungry to see people healed. It's not just submitted to the will of God. Oh, God will show me when he wants. It's, I don't think that's, those days are over. You know, if you're not moving with the call, the command to love, then God's not going to try to help move you because you're not moving. You've sort of got to be moving, hungering after the things of God. Then you go, oh, I can work with this guy. I can work with this person because they're already moving. So anyway, just think about some of the things to remove, some of the things to that God will provide. For me, it's strategy. Oh, God, would you show us how to reach everyone in 3214? What does that mean, reach, anyway? That they'd hear the real word of God, somehow to touch their hearts. And they'd see the Christians doing stuff that's inspiring and that turns them thirsty, makes them thirsty. What else? Remove pride and lust and greed and sloth and lots of things. It's good to think about, isn't it? Because the thing is, if we say, because we talk about pruning, this is a good place to finish. God wants to prune us, and to be fruitful, you've got to prune. I've got lots of little fruit trees in my garden. I was saying to me on the internet, don't expect fruit for 2 years. You've got to get them and prune them right so they're set for the fruit. Because if you give them fruit, if you let them fruit now, they'll be too weak and they'll break. So you've got to prune them so the stalks get strong so they can hold the fruit that's coming. And so we need to pray for pruning. Who's prayed for pruning before? That God would prune you. Have you?
Well, that was fun.
Oh, it's great. Lord, would you, look, why don't we finish on this? I'll just pray over us as we finish for the day. So Lord, we just thank you for this special day, and thank you that we've had a pretty amazing year in many ways, that we do feel the love, and thank you for the wisdom of Stavka saying that God's preparing a place of health such that new people can come in and feel this is a place to be healed. So Lord, we just say thanks for that, and just pray over us, Lord, as we finish up and head into a new week, that you prune us, that you prune off those worldly things we talked about. And I can't really pray this for everyone, but just as an example, that you come and prune us, Lord, give us a good shake, that you clean out the rubbish and cut off even the fruitful parts, that they can be more fruitful in 2022. And Lord, we just pray for this week that you'd show people visions and dreams for 2022, words of the Holy Spirit, words of power and prophecy and harvest, Lord, that it be a year of harvest. And so, Lord, we just commend each person to you and ask for you to wrap your loving arms around each of us where we're hurting or where we're struggling. You bear us up on angels' wings so that we can just be in that quiet place with you this week and grow and heal and prosper. Amen.
Happy days.
Okay, bless you guys. I just wanted to thank you all for all the support and all your commitment to the church and to God over this year, and I also want to really just honour Angus and Stavka for all of their leadership during the year. Can we just give them a little clap together? They've worked tirelessly, and done a lot of outreach where people see that, but Stavka's done a lot of stuff behind the scenes that is not seen in visitation and those sorts of things. So I just wanted to really just express my gratitude for them guys and all they've done. And for you guys. Bless you.